Good morning. I'm Barry Bryson. Thank you for joining me for another 5 Good Minutes with the Word. I know a couple of days ago I promised you that we would have 2 days of introduction to the book of Haggai, but I ran out of time yesterday. So we're going to take a third to talk a little more about the text itself of Haggai and about the phrase Second Temple Judaism. And I want to begin today by looking at Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. When the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order that he might redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive adoption as sons. God is bringing about the fullness of time. And one of the ways he did this was by sending his people into Babylonian captivity to purge them of their idolatry. He promised this in the prophets. We've seen this time and time again. And while they were in that captivity, as we detailed yesterday, there were two institutions that were established that are necessary to us to this day. The first was that the various texts that we think of as the Old Testament were collected, at least the ones that had already been written, were collected into a scroll. And so we could think of God's word not as the law and then the scattered writings and wisdom, but as a singular text itself. They could hold the Old Testament the way the Ethiopian eunuch did in his chariot, the way I can hold the entire Bible. And so that's part of the bringing about the fullness of time. The second institution would be the synagogue, because they couldn't get back to Jerusalem, but they had to have a place to study, a place to learn, a place to be Jews together in a society in which that was populated mostly by not Jews. They were no longer a theocracy, and they would never be a theocracy again, not the way they were under David. And so they had to learn how to be God's people among the nations, and we are God's people among the nations. And so in their synagogues, you know, they had sermons, they had songs, they made offerings. The things that we do in the church, in our churches, they were doing in their synagogues. We were so formed by this period of things that started to evolve during the period of captivity, and that solidified during the the reign of Alexander, and then the coming of Rome and the vastness of the Roman Empire, so that when Paul went to any town, he could start preaching in the synagogues because they were everywhere. And when churches became established, things like singing and sermons and making an offering and having a communal meal, that wasn't new to anybody. God had really prepared the fullness of time. And that's why the book of Haggai is such an important book, because the main thing they have to do to get ready for the Messiah is get themselves right with God spiritually and religiously. And they've laid the foundation of the temple, but they haven't finished building it. And it's been 17 years since the foundation has been laid. So let me continue on by talking about the timing. Haggai is quite specific in the dating of his oracles, and he delivers four. Two of them are delivered on the same day. He says in chapter 1, verse 1, in the second year of Darius the king, on the first day of the sixth month, the word of the Lord came by the prophet Haggai to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, saying. So he has an audience really of two people, the priest and the king. Not the king, but the governor. But Zerubbabel is the kingly figure because he's descended from David, and he's the forefather of Jesus. Joshua, who has Jesus' own name, is the high priest. So there's a connection there, don't you see, between preparing the way. You know, we have two different guys being priest and king. Jesus is, like Melchizedek, both a priest and a king. But he gives us the exact day. So this is August 29th in the year 520. And he dates all of his oracles that specifically. So this book takes place between August 29th, 520, and December the 18th, 520. It's delivered directly to these two guys to get them to motivate the people to finish the building of the temple. But it has so much more than that. You know, there's the accusing of the people of starting to be corrupted again in a variety of ways. And then there is the promise of something even better, that times are hard now because you're rebuilding, but times are going to be even better. And then we have a connection with the coming of the Messiah and the messianic promise by the end of the third chapter. So anyway, there's so much in the book of Haggai. It's really is a singular work, in that it's dated so specifically to such a specific time and a specific circumstance, and to really an audience of two men, Zerubbabel and Joshua, who together are a type of the Messiah who is to come. Okay, well, next time we'll get into the text and we'll look at chapter 1. Thank you for joining me for another 5 good minutes with the Word.